Good evening. Would you like to stand with us as we're going to worship? Amen. Welcome tonight, everybody. Amen. Welcome tonight. In Isaiah chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, the scripture says, "And in that day you will say, O Lord, I will praise you. Though you were angry with me, your anger is turned away, and you comfort me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid." Can you say that with me? God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For Yah, the Lord, is my strength and song. He has also become my salvation. Amen. Amen. Let's worship him tonight. Father, we just present ourselves to you tonight, God, as living sacrifices, Lord, that we can just worship you with our mouths, but Lord, with our hearts too, Lord. And you know everything that's on us, the burdens and everything, but tonight, God, we just pray that your spirit would be here, Lord, and you would have your way. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Through you the blind will see. Through you the mute will sing, through you the dead will rise, through you our hearts will praise, through you the darkness flees, through you my heart screams, I am free. Taken us from death into life. taken us from darkness into light. Let us go. Let us go. Let us go. Let us go into the house of the Lord. Let us go. Let us go. Let us go into the house of the Lord. We can praise Him, or we can worship the Lord. Oh, He is worthy. Oh, He is worthy of praise. He has taken us from death into life. He has taken us from darkness into light. He has taken us. Taken us from death into life. He has taken us from darkness into light. One more time, let us go. Let us go. Let us go. Let us go into the house of the Lord. Let us go. Let us go. Let us go into the house of our Lord. So loved this God rejecting world that He gave us His only Son, and He died for sinners like you and I, that we might have eternal. Loved this God rejecting world that He gave us His only Son, and He died for sinners like you and I, that we might have eternal life. Enter into the dwelling place of the Lord Most High. Enter in, for a refuge is in the Lord Most High. Enter in, enter in to the dwelling place of the Lord Most High. In for a refuge is in the Lord Most High. Singing praise, singing praise, hallelujah, hallelujah. For God so loved this God rejecting world that He gave us His only Son, and He died for sinners like you and I, that we might have eternal life. so love this God rejecting world that He gave us His only Son. We just thank you. We praise you. We love you, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for who you are. We just say hallelujah tonight. We just worship you. We pray together in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Why don't we greet one another tonight?
Praise God. The Lord is good. Amen. We have a couple of announcements, I believe. I'm just not positive what they are, so that guy might know them. Let's invite him forward. Somebody with information.
I think it's that Sunday morning we're having communion. So don't miss out on that. And if you're not able to come, I know there's a lot of brethren that are not feeling well, so you can get your elements and stuff ready at home. And if not, then we'll have communion here together. The prayer Saturday morning, doors open at 7:30. Also, Brother Daniel is going to announce Sunday morning, but there's a flyer up there you can start looking at for the men. It's a men thing, a guy thing. It's like, it's called like a men's retreat. So the information's up there, but the official announcement will be made Sunday morning. So that's what we have. Bless you.
Thank you. That's exactly what I was going to say. Took the words right out of my mouth. Praise God. The Lord is truly good, and even tonight as we gather, it's a blessing to see all your faces. I had promised last week we were going to have a guest speaker all the way from Mexico, and that's our Brother Fernando. For those of you at home or that don't know, our Brother Fernando is one of the leaders here in our church, one of our deacons, and ran into a situation with citizenship, and now he is working on the paperwork to be back in our midst, and Lord willing, real soon. So we're praying that way, that God would bring him back to not just his family, but the family of God as well, who is also his family. So he is sharing from long distance, so we're going to see a short video of our Brother Fernando's thought for the new year. So if we could get that set up, our Brother Benny, and then we'll continue in the life of David.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to each and every one of you guys. I hope you guys had a good, blessed, peaceful Christmas. It's just a blessing to be connected to you guys, to each other, you know. But here we are, another year. Another year as the Lord has blessed us with. This past year, it was a little different, but God is good. God is good. Today, the Lord has placed a thought as we really do it annually. A thought for us, you know, that the Lord has placed a thought that, you know, he's placed in my heart to share. I'm going to be in Ecclesiastes 5:4-5. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 4 and 5. The Word of God says, and here's how King Solomon wrote, when you make a vow to God, don't delay fulfilling it, because he does not delight in fools. Fulfill what you vow. Better that you do not vow than that you vow and not fulfill it. Wow. I think the scripture is made like for me, you know, especially like for me. Like, in other words, keep your word, right? Words may not mean much to us, but to God, they do. And in God's eyes, a promise is a promise. You know, we do it. We vow it. We keep it. And you know, like I said, this is like, I mean, I'm talking this talking this way, right? But for a second, let's consider this for a second. Think of what we have vowed to God. You know, what promises have we made to God? I mean, I can think right now a lot in my life, and you know, especially that when we're in situations and jams and trials and trouble and danger, we make these vows to God, and we come with these deals to God, you know. God, if you'll get me out of this predicament, if you get me out of this jam, if you get out of this trouble, I'll serve you more, or I'll come to church more, or whatever it is that we know what we vow to God, you know, in our prayers, in our times of trouble, right? Oh Lord, if you just help me with this one job, with this one thing, with this one door, if you could open is just one door, you know. I'll give you more 10% of my earnings, or I'll spend more time with you, or whatever it is that we vow to the Lord, promises we make to the Lord, even promises we make to people, even promises that I may not have with each promises that we make to our families, to our wives, to our kids, to people. I mean, I have a terrible thing with at my job. You know, I tell people, I know you're gonna call me right back. You know, here I am, 3 o'clock in the 4 o'clock in the morning. And I get up and oh man, I didn't call that person back. You know, and call them back the next day, man. You know, and we get into these sayings like better late than never, but it's not what it's all about. You know, we tend to our commitments. You know, our commitments that we make. You know. Commitments that we have, you know. Lord, I dedicate my life to you. I promise to spend more time with you. I promise to spend more time with my family, you know. And, you know, promises that we make, and especially unto the Lord. Unto the Lord, what commitments we have, what commitments we have with our church, with our brothers and sisters, commitments we have and responsibilities and obligations that we have, you know. And, the Lord gave me these few scriptures in Mark 14. This is where the Lord is being betrayed that night, okay? And in Mark 14:27. Word of God says, then Jesus said to them, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night, for it is written. So he's warning them, right? The disciples have a clue about what's that about to happen, right? Here's Peter in verse 29. Peter said to him, even if all are made to stumble, yet I will not be. Very stern, right? Very, he's not going to stumble, right? He's starting to kind of vow to the Lord there. But the Lord knows our heart. The Lord knows our heart, right? Well, here's where the answers to him, right? And we all know these scriptures. In verse 30, Jesus said to him, assuredly I say to you that today, even this night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times. But here you go, Peter, in 31, he didn't really pay attention to what he just told him. He said, but he spoke more vehemently. More with the passion, more intense. He's telling him, if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. And they all said likewise. Wow, what a vow there, right? He's making a vow to God there. He will not deny him, right? He will not deny him. And all the other ones agreed. But what happens in verse 54? Let's read there. Mark 14:54. But Peter followed him at a distance. Uh-oh. Now, things are changing here. Because first he was over here telling him he would die for him. And over here in 54 he's telling him, he's following him at a distance. Right into the courtyard of the high priest. And he sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. So he's getting comfortable here, right? He's getting comfortable. I don't know if he just... You know, it's like us, we get comfortable, you know, like, I went to church three times in a row now, I'm gonna chill out this time, you know, I deserve a break. You know what, I went to prayer last week, or like 2 weeks in a row. You know, I'm gonna take a break. You know, these commitments, you know, that we have with God, and I'm talking straight to me, because this is talking to me, actually, you know. But, you know, the Lord has places to share it with you. But you know, as Peter gets comfortable here, he's warming himself with the servants. He's following Jesus at a distance now. So if we get relaxed and we kind of like tend to forget, God has brought me out of this jam and that. You know what? And I at times forget what in my lifetime I kind of forgot actually what I even vowed to God. That's even worse. Right? So I'm not sure if Peter remembered here what he just vowed to God a few scriptures back, right? And now he's about to deny him, right? But he remembers, though. He remembers, right? So he's getting. So I think, you know, if we're not walking with the Lord, and we're walking at a distance, then we're with the world. It's either one. I don't think there's a. It's either one or the other, right? Either we're walking with the Lord, or we're walking at a distance, and we're warming ourselves up and warming ourselves up and with the world, feeling comfortable, feeling relaxed, feeling we can skip this. Oh, he'll do it. Oh, brother will do it. Oh, sister will do it. You know what? I'm gonna, you know, just take a break. And the Lord knows. Don't get me wrong. The Lord knows when we cannot keep a commitment, or the Lord knows when we absolutely can't keep it. There's situations we can't. But the Lord knows, because the Lord knows that he knew that Peter was going to deny him three times, right? The Lord knows, but the Lord also knows, we know when we choose not to keep a commitment, when we can, but we don't, and I'm probably the worst promise keeper that you could ever meet, you know. I'm the worst of the worst that a vow keeper, you know, and this here ministered to me what I'm sharing with you tonight, you know, that, you know, what promises, what time, your commitments, your life, your money have you made to God, you know, that you have not kept, that we have not kept? That's something to think about, to just be aware of those things. And one last scripture, second to the last scripture, I wanted to share our great example of a promise keeper, of a commitment keeper, of a word keeper. And we're going back to Mark 14:36. The word of God says here, and this is we know that Jesus was full 100% human, 100% God, right? And here, I believe here, his human side saying, praying here when he's about to be betrayed. In verse 36, and he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not that I will, but what you will. He was pleading here. He knew what was about to happen to him. He knew what he was going to go through. But he also knew that he came for this purpose. He came for this reason. He came to fulfill his commitment, his promise. What a great example to teach us, you know, to mean what we say, especially to the Lord, our vows we make, our promises we make, our commitments we make, we have, you know. So what a great example. He was asking if there is any other way. There's no other way. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. Amen. Amen. I wanted to leave that with you. I had one last scripture in, I believe, in Jeremiah. And we all know this scripture is one of my favorite ones. Also have a lot of favorite ones. In Jeremiah 33:3, call unto me. The word of God says, call unto me, and I will answer you. And I will show you big and mighty things that you do not know. And this year, he has big things in mind for us, each and every one of us. He has big things in mind, you know. But he wants us to, you know, to keep our commitment to him. Just a reminder. It was just a reminder, God's people, that God has placed this thought in my heart, and just wanted to share that with you. We'll be in touch. You guys have a happy new year. We'll be in touch. We'll be connected. Until we meet again, and God, he is still on the throne. Still on the throne. Amen, God's people.
Praise God. That was beautiful. We could just pray and say amen. That was, man, we all miss our brother so much, huh? Thank you. We're waiting for him to walk in the room. But he really blessed us. He really blessed us with that word. It's also going to be posted. So I just truly felt like we honored all the leaders with opportunities to be able to share a thought for the new year. And our brother Fernando is no less a leader because of where he's at than whether he was sitting here in our midst. So I appreciate you. We don't normally sit and stare at a screen, but we know that our brother had a good word, and that was a real blessing. Praise God. We're going to pick up with the remainder of the meeting in 2 Samuel. If you open your Bibles to 2 Samuel chapter 6, and we got through a majority of chapter 6 last week. And this is in the Life of David series. So this would be 2 Samuel chapter 6, part 2. And as you're turning there, we remember how chapter 6 started. It started with David on the mountaintop. It started where David had, they had taken back Jerusalem. They had defeated the Philistines. And it came to his heart to go and get the Ark of the Covenant. This was a representation of the presence of God. And he wanted to bring that back to Jerusalem. And as we went through last week, it was trying to do the right thing the wrong way. And we can all be guilty of that, trying to do the right thing the wrong way. And we remember what was shared last week, how he got 30,000 of his best men. And now that he was king over all of Israel, he got his best men and he went to go get the ark to take it to Jerusalem. And they put it on a new cart. And that was not God's way. God had shared in his scripture the correct way to transport the Ark of the Covenant. And it was on the shoulders of those who were consecrated, the priests, on the shoulders of them to carry it, not to be set on a cart, even if it was a new one. And it shows that the fact that it's a new cart, there was thought put into it. It's not like, go grab the dolly from over there so we can move the ark. It was, we're going to make this cart especially to honor God and to carry this, all with the right heart, but contrary to the word of God. And we have to be mindful and careful that we know the word of God well, because we could see people doing things unto the Lord and think, oh, they're doing it with the right heart. But it has to be in obedience to the word of God. That's more important than anything else. Just because you want something to be the right thing and try to do it for the right reasons, we have the word to instruct us. So as they did this, it said that Uzzah touched the ark because the ox bucked or stepped in a hole, but the ark started to fall. Uzzah touched it, dropped dead right there. Dropped it. No, it didn't work very well. He dropped dead right there, and this was a tremendous, because remember the celebration. This is 30,000 of his best men, and they all went, and all the people went, and it was a big, huge parade, and everybody was just rejoicing. We're bringing the presence of God back into Jerusalem where it belongs, and they're just, and as I mentioned last week, David was probably thinking, this is exactly what God had for me. Not hiding in caves, not running from King Saul. God told me I was going to be king over Israel. Now I'm king over all of Israel. And look at how everybody's rejoicing. And as we bring this presence of God back in the cart, and then Uzzah dropped dead. Poof, put a real damper on the parade. So as this happens, David becomes angry. And David becomes afraid. It says in verse 8 of chapter 6, 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 8. Well, we'll go to verse 7. It says, the anger of the Lord was aroused against Uzzah, and God struck him there for his error, and he died there by the ark of God. And David became angry because the Lord's outbreak against Uzzah, and he called the name of that place Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day, and he said, how can the ark of the Lord come to me? He was throwing his hands in the air. How can this holy ark come to me if Uzzah just dropped dead, in his opinion, for no reason? Because he was thinking with his own mind. He wasn't thinking like he was the last chapter when he was inquiring of the Lord for everything. When he was going to fight the Philistines, he was inquiring of the Lord. When he went back to fight him a second time, he was inquiring of the Lord. And God was directing him. With this, he just made a decision. We're going to do it this way because I think it's best. It's speaking of the holiness of God. And what he didn't understand is the holiness of God is something that must be respected. The Word of God says the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10. And there is absolutely, before I say this, there's absolutely no way to give a proper illustration of the holiness of God. There's nothing to compare it to. You can't say the holiness of God is like, because it's so huge. Because God's holiness, there's nothing to compare it. But this illustration came to my mind. You have to forgive me. I usually have to see things in that manner so I get a better understanding. And what came to my mind is this. Transporting a crocodile. What? I looked up and it said the largest crocodile ever recorded was 23 feet long and weighed over 2,000 pounds. That's a monster. That's a dinosaur. But do you think there must be specific instructions on how you would have to transport that crocodile? You think you just throw them in a cart and pull them along? Oh, they probably got steel cages. Have you ever seen them like round up a tiger and they put this cage to the side of the cage where there's an open door and they slide it up and then they chase the tiger in and then they shut the door and then they have them, they roll them around in the cart and put them. There's specific instructions on how, because of the sheer, imagine the sheer power of this crocodile at 2,000 pounds, 23 feet long. If the crocodile just moved its tail, 30 people would go flying in that direction. How much bigger is God? How much greater is God's holiness? See, they couldn't just do things the way they wanted. God said there's a proper order. You must show respect to the holiness of God. And they weren't showing that. So Uzzah learned the hard way. And truly that was David's lesson that was learned. So we see as we continue that it says that David put the ark in the house of Obed-Edom, which last week we even talked about. That must have been unusual to Obed-Edom to say, sure, I'll open the door to my house. The Ark of the Covenant just killed this guy, but go ahead and bring it into my house. But his household was blessed. His household was blessed. And it says, in verse 12, now it was told to King David, saying, the Lord has blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that belongs to him because the ark of God. So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with gladness. See, David saw that God was blessing Obed-Edom, but in 1 Chronicles 15, it gives instruction on what actually happened in that three-month time frame. He gained understanding. We shared a little bit of that last week, so I'm not going to go into it much further. But he gained understanding to know what the Word of God said. How it said it must be carried by the priests, those who were consecrated. See, how it had to be moved specifically by these poles that were through the holes in the side of this ark. So when David learned the proper way to do it, because he saw the blessings come, he was not angry, but his fear had changed. Does that make sense? There's a difference between the fear of God, because it's holiness, than just fear of something happening to you. That's a different type of fear. So his respect for God's holiness had changed. So he went and said, we're going to go and get the Ark of the Covenant. So they're going to go and take it from Obed-Edom's house. And it says in verse 13, And so it was when those bearing the ark of the Lord had gone six paces. And again, 1 Chronicles 15, it's 12 through 16, I think, are the verses. It talks about the Levites who were carrying it. These were the priests. As they were carrying it, it said that they had gone six paces, and then they offered a sacrifice of oxen and fatted sheep. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, and David was wearing a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of trumpets. Now, as I said before, David probably said, now I'm where God has me. Now I'm in the place showing God his proper holiness. Now we're bringing the presence of God back to Jerusalem, the joy that he had. The key is also not just the fact that he was dancing and worshiping and rejoicing, but it says he was wearing a linen ephod. It means he took off his kingly attire. He took off his king robe and his position as king, so the spotlight wasn't on him. He dressed as the other priests. The other priests wore a linen ephod. That's what the word of God says. That's how they were dressed. So in the midst of the priests, he dressed like them, and he joyfully danced unto the Lord. It says, with shouting and the sound of trumpets. I think the first parade was big. I believe this truly was much bigger, because the rejoicing was greater. The worship was greater. David wasn't dancing in the first one. And now he's dancing with all his might. He's rejoicing because the pain that he had, because it must have been 3 months that he sat there going, thinking of Uzzah laying on the ground, thinking, why did I put this on the cart? Why did God do this? Angry, fighting with God in his heart and crying out to God in whatever way he felt. Until he understood the word of God, until he looked back, until he understood there was direction. And when he understood God wasn't at fault, it was him that was at fault. See, so many times we go, God, why would you? God, why did you? And we don't look this way to see what we're doing, to see if we're right in God's eyes, if we're doing the things that he wants us to do. And if we are, the things that happen, he will direct us through. He's doing them for a reason. All things work together for good for those who love the Lord and those who are called according to his purpose. We know that. Romans 8:28. That's a scripture that we live by in this church, because God is so faithful. No matter what we go through, we know we can trust in him as long as we're committed in our heart to him. Amen. So David continues to enter the city with trumpets and shouting. Verse 16. Now the ark of the Lord came to the city of David, and Michal, and some say Michael, the different pronunciations. It's Michal is, I believe, the proper pronunciation. Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through the window and saw King David leaping and whirling before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. It doesn't say David's wife, because that's who it was. It doesn't say David's first wife, because that's who it was. But it says David, Saul's daughter, because that was true too. But she wasn't identified as David's wife. She was identified in three times in this chapter. They say the daughter of Saul. They don't say the wife of David. Just keep that in the back of your mind for a second. So it continues, and it says verse 17. So they brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place in the midst of the tabernacle that David had erected for it. What I want you to understand in regards to, and we'll go through it in chapter 7, because David has a desire to build a place for the Ark of the Covenant. What he built was a tabernacle that was like the tabernacle in the wilderness. It wasn't a building. It was something that they put up to be able to cover, just like they did with the animal skins and how it was set up in the desert. That's how David set this tabernacle up. So David erected this. Then David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. And when David had finished offering burnt offerings and peace offerings, and I mentioned last week what those two offerings were. The burnt offering was a representation of the consecration with Christ, and the peace offering is a representation of the fellowship with God. So the consecration with God and the fellowship with God, and these are the offerings that he lifted up. And it said, as he did this, in verse 19, then he distributed amongst all the people, among the whole multitude of Israel, both the women and men, to everyone a loaf of bread, a piece of meat, and cake of raisin. So all the people departed to their house. Praise God. That is triumph. That is joy. That is God's will being done to bring the presence of God, the Ark of the Covenant, back to Jerusalem. And everyone was happy. Everybody was rejoicing. How do you think David felt? We know how he felt the first time it cost Uzzah his life. He felt angry, then he felt afraid. How do you think he felt now that everyone had gone home with a picnic basket, ready to feed their families and to provide for them, and they all had just been rejoicing? You know, when we even have we have worship in the house of God, and we're worshiping God, and after worship, we're just like, thank you, Lord, and we're excited. We feel the presence of God. When we walked through the door, we had all these burdens from things that were going on outside, from things that happened in the day at work, things that happened in other places, and we get to the house of God, and we worship God, and we go, ah, thank you, Lord. Now I'm ready to receive your word. That's imagine how they felt in that same manner. Now the presence of God is back in Jerusalem. It's back in the tabernacle in the presence of Jerusalem around God's people. Everyone was singing. Everyone was rejoicing. Everyone was taking home their blessing. And it says that David even prayed a blessing. He said he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts. And then he distributed all his food. So we see David's frame of mind. And you know what's an automatic when you're on the mountaintop? That's when the enemy's gunning for you. Sometimes we think, oh, when things are going rough, as the enemy just keeps attacking, we have to be careful to be mindful of when things are going well. Because I think it was Charles Spurgeon that said it like this. He said, pirates, I'm probably going to say it wrong, but he said, pirates attack a ship that is full of bounty. Pirates don't go after a ship that's empty. They go after a ship that has stuff. And when we're being used by God, that's that same ship that the enemy sees. So now we get to verse 20. And David returned to bless his household. Now he's going home. He's had a long day. They've been rejoicing. He's probably all sweaty and tired and from dancing and leaping and rejoicing. But he had the materials to bless his own household as well. So it says he returned to bless his household. And I always mess this name up. I've said it already a few times right now. Michal. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, there it is again, came out to meet David. She didn't even let him come in. She came out to meet him and said, how glorious. How glorious. If I can turn the page. How glorious was the King of Israel today? That wasn't a lifting up. That was a slap in the face. She said, uncovering himself today in the eyes of the maids of his servants as one of the base fellows shamelessly uncovers himself. He came in joyful. And his wife said, how you really must be proud of yourself. You know how you just embarrassed yourself? And she didn't just say, like, the soldiers around you, your captains that went before. She said, the lowest of the maidservants were just looking at you. And you showed yourself to be like one of the base fellows. It almost sounds like lowlife. You're like a lowlife. Shameless. shamelessly uncovering yourself. She makes it sound like he was dancing in his tantarans out there or something. That wasn't what was happening. He was just out of his kingly robe. See, he wasn't in a situation where he wasn't showing anything. There was no, it's just the manner that she was affected by this because, see, her father was the king. So she could, in her own heart, think, I know how kings are supposed to act. I know how they're supposed to dress. They're supposed to have everybody under their thumb. They're supposed to be the one commanding them. They're not supposed to be happy and joyful and dancing. That's just that. She looked down on it like it was some horrible thing. But that's the first thing that met him at the door. He didn't even get in. It says she came out to him. He must have said, it's great to be home. But it says David had a few words for her. Verse 21. So David said to Michal, it was before the Lord. And that is very key. It was before the Lord. You know what he was saying? I wasn't dancing for you. I wasn't dancing for them. It was before the Lord. I was dancing for the Lord. This scripture is one scripture that's used so many times, and it's twisted. You know how it's twisted? Because people will do whatever they want, and they'll say, it's unto the Lord. See, I have permission because it's unto the Lord. If David would have been dancing by himself, then he would have been all eyes on me. He would have been, I'm in the spotlight, distracting everything else. But they were all dancing. They were all shouting. They were all joyful. If we're playing worship and someone decided to come in the back and sat on the couch next to Brother Frank with their tuba, I'm going to play along with the worship. Everybody be like, what in the world? I'm doing it unto the Lord. You can't tell me anything. See, there has to be an order. You can't do something unto the Lord that's going to distract and take away because now you're putting yourself in the spotlight. That's why when some people say, oh, they're filled with the Holy Spirit and they're going all crazy and they're knocking things down on the door. That's not of God. That's just wanting to have attention. Look how spiritual I am. That's a lie from the pit. David's saying, I was doing this before the Lord. I did this unto God. We were all worshiping. We were all joyful. We're all singing. What were you doing? Looking out the window at me with, it said, what's the word it used? In her heart. Now I have to look. She despised him in her heart. That's a heavy word. But then David kind of takes the gloves off here. He says, it was before the Lord. And then he continues, who chose me instead of your father and your whole household. He said, yeah, I was dancing before the Lord. It's me. Yeah, I was the king today, and I showed this before the people. And God chose me instead of your dad and your whole family. Because those are the next in line, could have been the next, the children in line or whatever, but God didn't choose them. God chose David. So David's telling her to kind of a jab. So you're going to attack me, I'm going to give it right back to you. That's not a good thing. I'm just saying what happened. Okay? I'm just describing the situation. So he said, who chose me instead of your father and all his house to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord over Israel. Therefore, I will play music before the Lord, and I will be even more undignified than this, and I will be humble in my own sight. He said, I'm just getting warmed up. I'm going to glorify God. I'm going to worship God. I'm going to be joyful in the Lord. And nothing is going to stop me from doing that, from worshiping God, from true worship. See, that's what's important, is having true worship. It's not just a matter of of being in the midst of worship. It's talking about worshiping God. Raising our voices, raising our hands. That doesn't mean we have to do it as a robot. Or this is the part we raise our hands. The song said, raise your hands unto the Lord. So everybody raise. That's not what it's about. It's about us unto the Lord surrendering. When we raise our hand, we're saying, I surrender to you, Lord. I surrender myself to you. And when we do that, we do it with a genuine heart. That's true worship. So it says, I will play music before the Lord. Therefore, I will play music before the Lord. I will be even more undignified than this, and I will be humble in my own sight. But as for the maidservants of whom you have spoken, by them I will be held in honor. He said, you're saying they're all judging me, thinking I'm one of the low forms and undignified and I should never be king because of the way I'm acting? You're the only one that feels that way. See, because they were out there worshiping with you. They were out there joyful, praising God, worshiping the Lord. He goes, and I will be held in honor in their eyes. Verse 23 in the last verse. Therefore, Michal, the daughter of Saul, again, third time, had no children to the day of her death. See, it's a touchy situation because he's looking at them and saying, they're going to honor me. They're going to lift me up. And it says that she had no children. That was considered a curse then. That they said it was a curse not to be able to have children was thought of in the Old Testament to be a curse from God. But many just think David said, I'm your husband, and I'm not going to be anywhere near you. So you're not going to have any children. And just cast her off to the side. Because remember, to his heir, David had wives. David had concubines. He might have said, oh, all the maidservants, they may be next in line here. They'll replace you. Like I said, that wasn't a positive towards David. David was human. That was the thing of the day that I mentioned before when we talked about this, that it was a stature issue. You were big stuff as a king. You showed how much power you had and authority by wives and concubines and all these things. It was contrary to God's word, though. I don't want to digress here, but I'm going to close with this. There's two points that I believe this is showing us. One of them is, are we fearful of displeasing God? Are we fearful of not showing God that he's holy? Not treating him in the manner of holiness that he deserves? Do we disrespect God by playing with the things of God? And second is, are we worshiping God with praise and honor that he's worthy of? And that's only something that we can look in our own hearts. See, while we're going through the life of David, we're just examining his life and what God did in his life. But we can always look to our own life in the same way. We can hold it up to this and say, God, help me to be fearful of displeasing you. Don't make it so easy for me to fall into sin. Make me feel the conviction when I'm falling in a direction or looking in a direction or feeling a certain way. Because God, I don't want to be disrespectful to you. I want to continue to allow to see your holiness, to have that relationship with you. The word of God says that sin separates us from God. We also know we all fall short of the glory of God, but we must seek his face, ask for his forgiveness, and draw close to him, just like David did. David fell short. It took him 3 months. But then he understood what God had done. And he worshiped God. It says, with all his might. When's the last time we worship God with our whole heart? There's been times in our lives, in our walk, where I know every single one of us have had tears coming down our face because we're just overwhelmed by God's presence and how good he is. You know that he's still the same today than he was that day? Let's remember he's worthy of our honor and our praise. He is holy. I apologize for the crocodile story because I don't want that to seem disrespectful in any way, but it's just to understand the holiness and the power of the creator of the universe. We think that crocodile is massive and strong. God created that thing. This is made by his hand. This is the God we serve. And as we see these things happen, we see Uzzah drop dead and we say, wow, man, I'm sure glad that we're not living in Old Testament times. God is just as holy as he was that day as he is today. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So remember this tonight as we continue to go forward in the life of David, that we can glean from his life, but we need to apply it to ours as well. So I'm going to ask you to stand. I'm going to call the musicians forward, and we're going to pray. And as always, we want to give an opportunity for anyone who wants prayer. The altar will be open, and you can come forward. The leaders will come and pray with you. So as we stand, I'm going to ask you to bow your heads, and we're going to pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word, Lord. We thank you for this word from our brother Fernando, Lord, as it blessed us tremendously, Lord. You continue to cover him, keep him safe, bless him in a special way, Lord, as he seeks your face. Father, we pray you would have mercy upon him and allow him to even come home to his family, Lord, to the family of God, and continue to use him where he's at, Lord. But Father, above all things, do your will in his life and his family's life as well. Continue to encourage his wife and his children as they're away from him, Lord. Continue to cover them and keep them, provide for them, Lord, as a family. And Father, continue to go before each and every one of us as well. We ask you to bless this time of prayer. And Father, just to move in a mighty way in each one of our hearts, Lord. Help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. And to see you as the holy God that you are. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The altar is open. If anyone desires prayer, you come forward. Praise God.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. And I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. And I just want to speak the name of Jesus to every hurting heart here right now, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing. Breaks every stronghold, shines through the shadows, burns like a fire. And I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. Power, your name is healing. from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name of Jesus. Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness. Every enemy, Jesus, for my family, speak the holy name of Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, and your name is life. Every stronghold shines through the shadows, burns like a fire. Just tell me your name is power. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Breaks every stronghold. Shines through the shadows, burns like a fire. And I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence, I speak Jesus.
Thank you, Father. Lord, we just thank you. We give you honor. We give you praise, Lord, Father. And Lord, we just give you the rest of this day and the rest of this week, Lord, Father. Lord, we want to continue just honoring you and giving you praise, Lord, Father, in all that we do and how we live our lives and how we conduct ourselves, even at work, at home, Lord. Lord, we ask you to be with us, convict us, and give us strength, Lord Father, from day to day. And Lord Father, we just thank you for this service and ask you to be with us in the rest of this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.